Hi, everyone. Welcome. Thank you for joining us tonight. I'll just give people another second to log on. And then we'll get started. All right. So again, thank you so much for joining us tonight. My name is Gianna. I'm one of the reference librarians here at the Chelmsford Public Library. So tonight, Chelmsford Public Library presents La Serenissima, a sojourn in Venice. Venice has been known as the Most Serene Republic, or La Serenissima, from its early incarnation as a refuge from invaders to its current place as a tourist mecca. Local photographer, art and history enthusiast Bruce Magnuson will explore the many facets of Venetian history, art, and architecture, weaving local references to Venice, such as the Gardner Museum in Boston, with photographs from a recent trip. You'll come away with a greater appreciation for its complicated, captivating city. So after retiring from a career in financial services, Bruce Magnuson, our speaker tonight, has pursued his interests in photography, art, and history. He has had photographs in multiple shows at the Griffin Museum of Winchester, and other various venues, including the Chelmsford Library, and one show featured his infrared photographs at the Acton Library. He has presented on a wide variety of topics ranging from international affairs, social justice, art, photography, and the history of his home region, the Hudson River Valley. So without further ado, I'm gonna pass it over to Bruce.
Okay, thank you, Gianna. All right, I see a couple of folks have put where they're from in. So if people want to pop in there, see how wide our 150 plus audience is from across the Northeast. So this is La Serenissima, Sojourn in Venice, which before I actually started this, I always thought sojourn meant journey, but sojourn actually means a short stay. So I was in Venice for about 5 days with my family in the middle of April. Wow, Huntsville, Alabama. So I guess I can't level set because people are all over the place. DC, Billerica, Andover, Fort Myers, Florida, Deerfield, Illinois, Amesbury, Chicopee, North Chelmsford. Shout out to Jack Eichel. Stanley Cup champion is bringing the Stanley Cup locally here in the middle of July to skate three up in Tingsboro. Nashville. Well, I might be going to Nashville actually in a couple of months. Westport, Connecticut. Okay, great. Quite a selection from across the United States. So that's cool. So with that, we will get started. And, you know, Venice is a place that has been around for 1,000, 1,500 years and a rich history and a lot of opinions about it. And we'll start with our friend Goethe, the German essayist, scientist, general polymath. He said as of 1786 in the 18th century, so much has been said and written about Venice already. That, of course, did not stop people from doing so. So our friend Mark Twain, who his first big book was called Innocents Abroad, where he took a trip through Europe, and he had this to say about Venice: the old Venice of song and story has departed forever. She sits among her stagnant lagoons, forlorn and beggared, forgotten of the world. And more recently, Gore Vidal: Venice itself is perhaps the most beautiful cliche on earth. So you have a whole crisscross of opinions on Venice. So for an agenda, we'll start with an orientation, since I can't really say if how many people are familiar with Venice. I wasn't really specifically about its geographic location, some of the nuances of the lagoon. We'll take a look at its origin story, its rise to power as a mercantile power in the Middle Ages. We'll dip our toe into art and architecture, and then we'll take a look at Venice today. So as an orientation, I see the webinar chat. We do have a Q&A. So if people do want to pop questions in there, I'll try and, you know, take some breaks as we go through the program to answer some questions. Obviously, the questions will be, you know, pertinent to where I've been, so I don't want to let them sit in the Q&A too long, but folks have questions. I'll try and pay attention to that. So here we have Venice here in the northern part of the Adriatic Sea up here in northern Italy. This is actually the Po River that dumps out just south of the Venice Lagoon. And this is the Venice Lagoon, with the island that we know of Venice is right here, kind of smack dab in the middle. This is the Lido, kind of the breakwater. And these are some entrances where the Adriatic tide flows in and out. And this will become important at the end of the presentation, where we go into what's going on in modern day Venice, where they're trying to protect Venice from the ravages of Mother Nature and rising sea levels and all that kind of fun stuff. And you see, I'm not going to go into them into too much detail, although I did visit them. There's the island of Murano, which is famous for its glassmaking. And then there's the island of Burano, which is famous for lace and also very pastel-y painted buildings there. Let's see if my button works. It does work. So Venice is broken up into six districts, which are called sestieres. Venice is also known as, it looks like a fish. So you can kind of see this here. This is the island of Venice with the six sestieres from Canareggio, which is where we stayed, which is just in the northwest part of Venice. And San Marco is obviously the most popular place of Venice, where San Marco Basilica is, where the Doge Palace is. This is kind of where all the hordes of people eventually end up here. And it's pretty easy to walk through Venice if you just follow the signs and the people. Ultimately, you end up in San Marco. But this is the Grand Canal, which cuts through Venice, and kind of this is the mouth of the fish, and we'll leave the other part to your imagination. And this is the island of Giudecca, which is the Giudecca Canal right here. And this is the island of San Giorgio, both of which are reached by the public transportation, the Vaporetto. And this is a little more detail of the way Venice looks. And it's only, you know, basically 2 miles and about a mile and a quarter from its largest width. So this is a quick video that my wife took of the Grand Canal, 56 second kind of look. Thought there was sound with this, maybe there's not, but the Grand Canal is, you can see the buildings go right up to it. You've got your gondolier going through there. I mean, all the cliches of Venice. You know, when we got there, we were right by the Grand Canal and the bridge that crossed over from the Piazza Roma, and it's everything you've seen. There's a lot of activity on the Grand Canal. It is a, you know, bustling thoroughfare of not just passenger boats going on, but basically all the transportation within Venice does go by water. So as a result, the Grand Canal is by far the widest expanse of water, and it's pretty neat. So this is taken actually from one of the public buses, the Vaporetto, which we will get into at the end of the presentation, some pluses and minuses of that. Some quick Venice by the numbers. It's made up of about 117 islands. The story is there's basically as many churches in Venice as there is islands that made it up. So there's well over 100 churches in Venice. It was first settled in 421 as a refuge from various invaders as the fall of the Roman Empire happened. The population of the greater Venice area there, they do consider some parts of the mainland as Venice, but the actual island is around 55,000. I think in its heyday, it was around 200,000 people that lived there. Anywhere from the numbers I've gotten, anywhere from 5 to 20 million tourists visit every year. So the kind of resident to tourist ratio is off the charts. There are about 150 canals, over 400 bridges. Like I said, it's a little over 2 miles long and about a mile and a quarter at its widest. Only four bridges over the Grand Canal: the Constitution, Academia, Rialto, and Scalzi. Constitution was just built in 2008, and we'll get into that at the end. And it is sinking about 1 to 2 milliliters, millimeters every year. So the origin story of why is Venice. You know, I had a hard time getting my head around it until I actually went there. You know, I've heard so much about Venice. You know, it's an island city, the floating city. It is not a floating city, really. But how does something like that end up being, and supposedly, particularly being from around 700 to today? So it is built upon logs, about 10 million of them. So this is a bit of an eye chart, but it is a good cross section of, you can see, as you get down to the actual base of the lagoon, you have these logs that are pounded in. You can see kind of a better representation here. And then on top of that, you have various stones that are built up to get basically the foundation of what Venice is built on. And it may seem kind of strange, but it's actually how a lot of Boston is built. When I worked in Boston downtown, they excavated the 75 State Street project. If folks remember that, who were Bostonians, the infamous Billy Bulger project. But when they basically took down the building, it exposed water. And there were logs basically driven in during colonial times. And as long as the seawater stayed above and the logs didn't dry out, they basically come to kind of had the consistency of concrete. So they are a very, very stable way of building things as far as that goes. So that is basically how Venice came to be. For a little more detail on this, there was a NOVA on PBS. They did a show on Venice a couple of months ago. It was probably in March. And this is a short excerpt of that, which gets into a little more detail of exactly how Venice came to be.
Venice was born in the lagoon because the lagoon was useful to Venice. So Venetians shaped the lagoon the way they wanted.
But this environment posed a problem. How could they build on such soft ground?
I'm not that heavyweight. I weigh 65 kilos, but I'm sinking like this.
65 kilos is around 140 pounds. If the mud can't support this, how could it bear the weight of a wooden house, let alone one of Venice's grand stone buildings? The solution? Forcing wooden poles into the soft mud. These poles don't support the weight. They transform the mud around them.
The idea is to do a little experiment. When you plant many poles, they compact the mud between them. The water is pushed out, and the compaction of the mud itself make the mud more capable of supporting weight.
Modern-day excavations under the city reveal that Venetians maximize the compaction of the mud by using a large number of poles packed tightly together. Directly on top, they placed wooden planks, then impermeable limestone, and above the waterline, bricks.
No, qua così, lo metti qua così. You see, I'm lightweight, more than him. He can also try. Okay, you see, Omar is not sinking because it's the effect of the pores that compacts the mud between them. So it changes from more, I would say, fluid-like to more solid-like. And the proof of this is when we put the plank over there and do the same thing on the mud without the pores underneath. You see, there's a difference.
This technology is the secret of Venice's construction and longevity. And over the centuries, they created the city we see today.
So pretty amazing. And like I said, when we were there, we did take one of the vaporettos out to Burano, which is about an hour plus boat ride on the lagoon. And once again, trying to get my head wrapped around, like, how did this place come to be, and, you know, kind of what's there. And so this is the best I could come up with, taken from the vaporetto, this kind of marshy thing that's still there today. Obviously, you see a marina kind of behind it in an island. There's actually a lot of islands in the lagoon. But this, to me, gives at least some representation of what you might have been looking at, you know, in 400, 700 AD, when you came into the lagoon, and then they transformed this with these 100 plus islands into Venice. So it's a pretty amazing story. This is actually another shot looking the other way from the lagoon. And these are actually the Dolomite Mountains, the Alps, that are about 2 hours northwest, I guess, of the lagoon in Venice. But you can see them kind of lurking over it. And these are the clouds here, and these are the snow-capped mountains of the Dolomites. So it was pretty intense and, you know, very, very atmospheric vision here. And then here you have these stakes in here, which is they carved out channels throughout the lagoon that are basically dug a little bit deeper. And those were all the shipping channels that people can kind of navigate through the lagoon. I think the lagoon average depth is like 15 to 17 feet, not that deep, but they have excavated deeper parts of it. So San Marco is the kind of the patron saint of Venice, hence St. Mark, San Marco Basilica, St. Marco's Square. You know, as most of these churches in Europe, they have to have relics to kind of establish their worthiness and their veracity. So the story of San Marco is St. Mark, he did die in 62 AD. He ended up in Alexandria, Virginia. Egypt. And, you know, Venice is a great trading city-state, and they were in Alexandria, and they had had St. Theodore as their patron saint, but I guess they needed an upgrade. So they decided that they would, you know, kind of, this is a Muslim country, a Muslim city in Egypt. So they figured that they would take it back to a Christian country, and they smuggled out the remains of St. Mark in a, they say a barrel, various stories about what it is, but some sort of vessel covered in pork, because that's an unclean meat for the Muslims, and they wouldn't check. So that's how they smuggled it out in 892 and moved it to Venice. And so there's a lot of Venetians still are named Marco today, and the winged lion, which is a symbol of St. Mark, that is also the symbol of Venice. And it became a pretty famous painting. We'll get to the Academia Museum a little bit later, but this is a painting by the famous Venetian artist Tintoretto. It's an unfinished painting. You can see kind of these parts of these buildings really are still in kind of grayscale, but this is basically his representation of them taking the body from Alexandria and bringing it to San Marco and Venice. Of course, a lot of poetic license, since at this point, St. Mark has been dead for 800 years. So I'm not sure he's gonna look like that, but that's the myth and the backstory of how we get St. Mark's associated with Venice. Now, as I said before, Venice was a mighty trading power, and basically its heyday was in the Middle Ages, where it was the centerpiece of commerce for both the East and West. And that really lined its coffers and accounted for its incredible wealth. And you can see this, you know, how far ranging the Venice Republic was. You know, it really was kind of around the Adriatic, and get here, particularly on the east coast of the Adriatic, and you go down here as to what is modern day Greece and the Peloponnesian Peninsula. You get into Crete, which we'll get to in a second, and then you have all these, what are today the Cyclades Islands as part of Greece. And a lot of these are more, you know, you get these different colors of red versus kind of pink. You know, this is a little much stronger control that they had of a particular entity, and this is a bit less of control. I guess Venice was, you know, they didn't have a lot of desire to actually take over these things, to rule them, as opposed to they wanted basically trading outposts. Hence why Crete was so important to them, because Crete is, you know, basically at the bottom of the Adriatic, and going into the Aegean Sea to get here and go through Constantinople, end up in the Black Sea and continue on there. So it was a pretty far ranging in the Adriatic and the Aegean Sea. And if you were with me last month when I talked about our trip to Athens and Crete, Crete was ruled by Venice for over 400 years, from 1205 to 1669. And the town city we stayed in Crete was Hania, here on the western end, northwestern end of Crete. And, you know, once again, I had really no knowledge of this kind of influence, but the place we stayed is the old town, which is this old Venetian fort. And so this is kind of a modern day map of it. And you can see certainly the outline is there, the breakwater, the lighthouse. This basically forms the harbor that is Hania. You know, this is an older view. And of course, you can see here the very, very real outlines of a fort here, and the breastworks and the corners that you have, and this whole outline here of the old fort that basically was the fortifications of the city of Hania. And today, the lighthouse still stands. Parts of it were built in the 1500s. I think other parts had to be redone in the 1800s, but it is a pretty much an all-stone lighthouse, and it's at the end of the breakwater, and it's a fabulous photographic subject. But once again, it was a protectorate, a entity ruled by Venice for over 400 years, and I believe it was the Ottomans that took it over after 1669. So the government structure, everybody talks about the Republic of Venice, and it was not really a republic as we know it. You know, voting wasn't a big thing. It was ruled, the unique thing is it was not ruled by a monarch, which if you think about the time frame we're talking about here, you know, basically 700, 800 AD up until it was finally The Republic ended in 1797. So you have basically 1,000 years, and it was not ruled by a monarch. It was ruled by a person who was elected called the Doge, which translates to various things, Duke, Mayor, but he is elected for life, but most of the time the Doge is elected very late in life. So that keeps their longevity short. But between 1726 and 1797, there are 120 Doges. And basically it was a plutocracy, not a republic. So you had this pyramid here of this governing structure, and you have the General Assembly, which is the biggest one, but still it consists of only about 10% of the population and includes nobles and representatives from the trade organizations. And you have, and then you kind of basically narrow it down until you get up to the Doge. And there was also a breakout here called the 10, I believe. And it does have kind of a rough history. They were, you know, it was a very draconian rule, and they did create a very strong sense of self with Venice. So the population kind of rallied around it. And it was a small island, you know, us against the world was pretty much literal. So obviously to, you know, exist for 1,000 years, relatively the same kind of government is pretty amazing. And like I said, it was not, you know, that when you talk about a republic, I think our views of republic today are more egalitarian. And, you know, basically we have elected representatives who vote on the behalf, you know, technically we're a republic here in the United States. This was much more of a plutocracy, oligarchy for a better term. 100 families controlled the city and were allowed to participate in government for the most part. But, you know, within the context, certainly of Europe and even within other, you know, countries we know of, China, those type of things, during this 1,000-year time frame, this was pretty unique, where most places, you know, went toward a single monarch type of structure. So the Piazza San Marco is, you know, the most famous part of Venice. What I find interesting in it is, we'll get into this a little bit more with some pictures, but here you have the Basilica of San Marco, which is, this is where the artifacts of St. Mark are. This is the Doge's palace. This is the famous Bridge of Sighs, and this is the prison. So you have kind of one-stop shopping here, because literally the seat of government is connected to the church. The Doge actually would go in like the back door when he went to a service at St. Mark's Basilica. And then the Bridge of Sighs, which is incredibly famous, of course, basically the court is over in here. And if you're basically convicted, you go across the Bridge of Sighs and right into the prison. And some of the cells in this prison, it got pretty nasty. And these things here, there was a lot of public executions between these two pillars that are right on the water in San Marco. So it's a pretty interesting kind of, you know, juxtaposition here of your very, very large entities that rule the government, and basically everything kind of happens in this very, very small square on the southeast part of Venice. So the Doge's palace, you know, this is the ruler of this mercantile empire, and they let you know it. So you can, you know, take a tour certainly of the Doge's palace, and it's a bit overwhelming. It's one of these places where photographs may not really do it justice, but they didn't spare any expense, and the artisans there certainly wanted their work to be shown in these incredibly ornate and grand halls. And you start off with the golden staircase, which you walk up to get into the Doge's palace, and then you go into these various rooms that have all these ceiling paintings that are pretty amazing. And it's actually a question about the poles, and they did deforest the land around Venice. That's interesting. I haven't heard that. The question was, they must have used hundreds of poles to develop Venice. Did they deforest the land around Venice? That's an interesting question. I mean, certainly they did that in England. And that's one of the reasons they love to come over here to New England and find our very strong, tall white pines for ship's mast. I didn't hear a lot about they actually deforested. There's a lot of questions about how they actually got those poles over. All these ancient things are just kind of blow your mind when you think about what they were doing with what little technology they had. So Doge's palace is nothing if not ornate. And as I said before, this is actually looking, it's kind of a U-shaped courtyard here is with the Doge's palace. And looking out, this is the back of St. Mark's Basilica. So you see the different basilica domes there. This is the courtyard. So it literally is connected to the basilica. And this is kind of the Tree of Doges. This is a painting inside the Doge's palace, which basically shows all the Doges from the 700 to 800s up until the last one in 1797. So it's a pretty visceral depiction of just how many Doges there were in the course of a 1,000-year republic. And this is the Bridge of Sighs, taken pretty much from every angle. This is the famous picture as a canal goes through, the gondolas go through here just continually. You know, this is one of the classic scenes, obviously the Bridge of Sighs, which I think was coined by Byron. As you go across from the Doge's court over to the prison, this is actually the inside of it. As you walk this narrow passageway and you end up in these prisons, which are cleaned up a bit, I'm sure, from the time, but they're, you know, pretty harsh places and, you know, all stone, I imagine pretty cold and damp and not a lot of fun. So the merchants of Venice, it was the first capitalistic system, basically, well before Dutch and English. What it got its start in was as a monopoly on salt, since they were in a lagoon. Salt was very plentiful, and so they basically cornered the trade on salt, and that kind of sent them off to the races, and they began this great trading empire, which was a major slaving trading hub that started in the 1100s. They were equal opportunity. So they made a lot of money carrying the Crusaders to the Holy Land. As the Crusades were going on in the Middle Ages, Venice became a transporter of the Crusaders over to the Holy Land. And these churches become more and more ornate as the city's wealth increases. And some of the foxes, some of the quotes that come up in the context of Venice are foxes in a world of lions, and with truth and lies, you sell the merchandise. So it was a very, very mercantile organization. You had the aristocracy being mercantile people because one thing Venice is short of is land. So you don't get the landed aristocracy on the island. As we get to the architect Palladio a little bit, we'll get a little bit into kind of what happens on the mainland to a certain degree, and there is a lot more space there. But in general, you know, the hierarchy of these nations at the same time, you have these landed aristocracy, obviously England being the one we're probably most familiar with, but Venice doesn't really have that. So you get the merchant level kind of bumped up to a higher level than you might see as far as the stratification goes of middle ages society. And that was a huge, huge part of what created Venice's wealth. So their trade routes range far and wide. And of course you have the stories of Marco Polo, who goes 20 years going across to China and coming back on these various routes in the 1200s, I believe. And you can see just amazingly how far ranging these things are and why it is so important. And you see Crete right here is right in the middle of all these different routes going from Africa, going here through Constantinople over to the Black Sea, as I said, you get into Russia, you get into China, through other areas, and it's amazing how it goes. And you go to the west here and you get over into, you know, all parts of so Northern Africa, up into Europe, and even into the English Channel. So it's very, very far reaching. And, you know, this whole thing about globalization is always kind of interesting because, you know, we always talk about it and, you know, kind of saying like, oh, we're, you know, on the forefront of it. And the truth is, you know, this kind of globalization, obviously it's a much more intense as it is today and things move a lot quicker, but the breadth and width of trading in those time frames was pretty amazing as to how far reaching these things were going. And of course, a lot of it has to do with the spice trades. You see these spice trades going, you know, basically all the way from the Indies, the East Indies, all the way through over to India, and then once again through the Middle East, and then back in Europe, and you kind of got Venice in the hub here. So Venice is really, because of its location and being a hub, is really how it is this city that kind of splits east and west. And we saw a little bit when we were talking with Athens there about a month ago. But what kind of begins the decline of Venice is when Constantinople gets taken over by the Ottoman Turks in the late 15th century. So that kind of cuts off all this. And so as a result, that's when Venice's republic and its mercantile stuff starts to constrict and eventually, you know, becomes the kind of tourist mecca it is today, not the trading mecca it is. So this is just a quick timeline. You can see it contextually, you know, what Venice is doing in the mid 1300s. You know, it's basically the cradle of modern banking, and you don't get the Bank of Amsterdam until the early 1600s. And of course, you have the basically the rise of Venice banks and Venice bank failures. You know, the Bank of England doesn't come until the late 1600s. So Venice is a good 250, 300 years before what we kind of consider, you know, the modern capitalistic thing is, you know, the East India Company of both England and Holland, and those kind of things that happen in the Pacific, and then of course here in North America, when England and France and Spain start going into both North America and South America. So the other kind of big thing that makes Venice be able to sustain itself over the centuries is its arsenal. So this is kind of a forerunner to modern industrialization. You can kind of make the argument that this is really kind of the first assembly line that happens, and they can crank out these ships, because obviously Venice's power is maritime power. You know, their whole thing is based on, they have their island. It's very hard to invade the island. There's a couple of examples of some that tried and they flounder on the sand spit of the Lido, or they, you know, squander themselves in the lagoon. So Venice is fairly well protected being an island nation, but in order to enforce its trading routes, protect its interests in those things, it has to have a good navy, and it does. And what it can do is crank out ships. And so it can crank out basically a fully fitted galley type of ship, can be either commercial or military, in about a day. Which is kind of crazy. And the story is that they would kind of show this off to, you know, potential trading partners, even potential adversaries. And they would see the fact that they could crank out a ship a day. And they're like, okay, maybe we should trade with these people, not fight with them. So it is a big deal as to explain really the rule of Venice for such a long time. And it is, I did not get a chance to visit it. It is still there to a certain extent. A lot of it has been taken over by the Modern Art Festival that happens every year. 1 year is architecture, the other year is art, is the Biennale, and that takes place in the arsenal here, kind of on the southeastern tip of Venice. So it is kind of out of the way. So we were staying way up here and we didn't make it past San Marco, but the arsenal to a certain degree is still there. It was fortified and it was, I think it employed like 16,000 people at one point. So it was quite a big operation and really accounted for a lot of Venice's mercantile success. And as with every empire, it eventually declines. So as I mentioned, its heyday was in the Middle Ages. It begins a gradual decline. One of the famous quotes from the 18th century is, the English use their powder for cannon, the French for their mortars. In Venice, it's usually damp. And if it is dry, they use it for fireworks. So it becomes less of a military mercantile thing. Really, like I said, you know, kind of with the takeover of Constantinople in the late 1400s, Venice starts to kind of begin its quote unquote decline, become less of a military power and become more of a, you know, fun place. It actually ends in 1797 with our friend Napoleon, basically surrendered for the most part without a shot. He ends up turning over to the Austrians, and it kind of goes back and it has a revolution to try to gain its independence in the 1840s with the revolutionary period there in Europe. And then eventually in the 1860s, I believe, it becomes part of the unified Europe and Garibaldi and all that. So it becomes part of Europe, which once again, we don't really think about that a lot. A, how short a time ago that was. And B, you know, it didn't just happen in a snap of a finger. And Venice always was very different than the other city states within Italy, the Italian peninsula, not least of which is because it's obviously just based on water and it was facing more east than the other ones. So it's kind of assimilation into Italy. And we think of it today as kind of a take it for granted. But once again, that was a bit of a bumpy ride. And as that quote from Mark Twain that I said at the beginning, during the 1800s, it becomes kind of run down. It becomes this incredible mecca for artists. And it's really hard to find an English-speaking artist, both writing and painting, who doesn't end up in Venice if they're alive during the 1800s, doesn't end up there at some point in their life and do something significant. Henry James wrote books that were set there. Like I said, Mark Twain's first best-selling book, Innocence Abroad, part of that takes place in Venice. We'll see some of the painters that go there, but the 1800s is certainly a mecca for artists to go in Venice. And so with that kind of transition, we'll kind of dip our toe into the art of Venice. And this is taken at the Accademia, which is one of the art museums. And we'll see here that there's basically four, excuse me. And the only one I went to was the Accademia. There is this La Galleria, there's the Peggy Guggenheim collection, which is probably one of the most famous one. And that's her collection is modern art. And then there's the Della Dogana, which I believe is in St. Mark's Square, but the Accademia was the one we went to. And I was very glad we did. It's really a great museum, particularly since it really does focus on Venetian artists, which, you know, is not necessarily, I mean, obviously museums that are much larger can have a lot bigger and broader scope, but this basically is focusing on Venetian artists. And of course, there was no shortage of titans, particularly during the Renaissance of Venetian artists. You have Titian, Tintoretto, Giorgione, Bellini, Veronese. They're all well represented here. Some of their masterworks are here. And it's not a huge museum and it's not tiny, but I will say the one thing about Venice, like most of these cities you go to in Europe, one of the criteria is that, you know, how crowded is it? How much time do you have to wait to get in there? So you go to the Uffizi in Florence, you know, you have to get the skip the line tickets. If you want to see the David sculpture in Florence, you have to certainly buy tickets well in advance in order to make sure you get in there and don't spend your whole day waiting in line. The Accademia was wonderful. We had no plans. We walked up on a Tuesday morning and we were able to get in no problem, and it wasn't incredibly crowded. Somebody put a question about the Commissario Brunetti novels by Donna Leon, because her writing makes me feel like in Venice. Can you recommend any authors who did the same? And yes, I did read one of her novels after I got back, and I totally agree with that. And at the end, I had sources, about 20 or 30 or so books that I used, and I highlighted some that I thought were particularly noteworthy. So we'll get that to the end, and I'll point out some of the books that I found were really evocative of Venice. So we have these titans here, and I'm not going to go through the whole collection, but this one I found was, the backstory was kind of interesting. It's Veronese's Feast in the House of Levi from 1573, and Canaletto, yeah, we'll get the Canaletto. And this is huge. You can see, you know, this is basically taking up a whole wall in a room, but the backstory was the Inquisition was active. It was originally called the Last Supper, and the Inquisition said, well, the Last Supper has dogs, buffoons, drunken Germans, dwarfs, and other such absurdities. You can't be calling that the Last Supper. So either take those out or do something else. So the ever practical Veronese said, okay, I'll change the name. And so it became the Feast of the House of Levi, which is basically the Last Supper. And like I said, it really takes up the whole room, and it's quite impressive. But Canaletto, Canaletto was not a Renaissance painter, so I didn't put him in there with the giants, but he is. This is a weird story, because to the person who put the, Suresh, who put the comment in there, I associate my first, you know, association really besides Titian of an artist with Venice was Canaletto. And so I'm looking at the map in the Accademia and I see room 9 has Canaletto's. So I'm like, great. So we walk through, and next thing I know, I'm in room 11. I'm like, what happened to the Canaletto's? Like, I can't believe I missed them. So retrace our steps and we go into the gallery that has the Canaletto's, and it basically has one Canaletto. And it was this one, which is not what I would consider your typical Canaletto. I'll show you one in a second. But I found I didn't really get to any of the detail about what the story is about that. But I did find it kind of ironic. I've seen a lot of Canaletto's in my life, and I'm in Venice and I only have one in the Accademia. But if you're from the Boston area, you can see a Canaletto at the MFA in Boston. So this is the Bacino di San Marco from 1738. And this is kind of the quintessential Canaletto seascape, I guess is a better term, very detailed. If you get close to this thing, you know, the detail in this painting is phenomenal, and the way the water is represented and this whole scene. And he does a bazillion of them. But, you know, it brings kind of the whole thing with depicting Venice in art. As I mentioned, a lot of these artists, European artists in the 1800s, end up in Venice. And so if you saw, I did a presentation last year on the British painter Turner, and his last 10 years, maybe 10 or 15 years of his career, I think like 30% of his output is Venice. He only spends 3 weeks there, but a lot of his output is Venice. And this is one that's the Bridge of Sighs. I forget where this one actually is, but these two are in the National Gallery in DC, and they're fascinating to me because this is kind of your typical, almost, you know, Canaletto-ish type scene that's done by Turner. And then this also is Venice. And so Turner, if you're familiar with his career, he goes more abstract toward the end of his life, last 10 years or so of his career. And this to me is just a fascinating representation of that, because you have an earlier Turner and a later Turner, both the same subject of Venice. And of course, these paintings could not be any more different. And sticking with the theme of local, this is in the Met in New York, another Turner. And then back here at the MFA, it was amazing. I was just in the European art collection there on the second floor in the hallway. And where I look, all of a sudden, there's all these Venice paintings. And so this is one from Eugene Louis Bodin from 1895. And here we have Renoir, which I never knew really Renoir painted Venice, but he did. He had a painting of the Grand Canal in 1881. Like I said, this is at the MFA. And all this kind of leads us to Bostonians here. I realize a lot of people are on this call are not from Boston, but I'll give you a little kind of tidbit here. If you ever do visit Boston, one of the things you want to check out if you're into museums is the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum in Back Bay Fens, kind of diagonally across from the MFA. And of course, her building there was built back when the Back Bay was not what it is today. It was kind of just filled swamp, talking about filled swamps they did in Venice. They did the same thing in the 1850s in Boston, filled in Back Bay, and she built her Venetian palace there. This is actually a portrait of her in the museum, painted by John Singer Sargent in 1888. She was a great patron of his, and she was a great traveler. So they had an exhibit there just a few months ago. It's ended now, but she traveled in all these dark green locations are countries that she traveled in her life. And once again, this is the 1800s. She was born in the early 1800s and died in the early 1900s. I think she died in 1926. I think she was born in like 1830s or 40s. But she would create travel albums as well. So this is early days of photography in the 1800s. And she would compile photographs and clippings and all kinds of stuff on her travel and made these albums. And so they had this exhibit back in the spring that showed, displayed various albums she had put together. They actually made a book out of it. Although the book that they made did not include her Italian albums, but pretty amazing. And she was doing the grand tour and all that. And so she was taken with Venice. So one of the most famous hotels in Venice is the Hotel Danieli, which is right down by the Doge's Palace. And so we were walking there, we'd heard the Danieli. So we decided, you know, can we kind of sneak peek and see what it's like? And you walk into the lobby and it's like, not a big sign, but it's a sign that, you know, only people who are staying here can go beyond this point. But the concierge was very accommodating, so he let us in. We walk in here, and as soon as I look up, I'm like, oh my gosh, this is Isabella Stewart Gardner. You know, this is obviously where she gets this whole Venetian villa from. And so I did a quick search on the Hotel Danieli, ended up on TripAdvisor, and Hotel Danieli goes for about $2,000 a night. So we did not stay at the Hotel Danieli, although once you search on TripAdvisor, it will send you an email every couple of days saying, have you completed your reservation for the Hotel Danieli, which I found kind of ironic since I was not going to be paying $2,000 a night. But it is an incredibly beautiful place, and the building itself, that goes back to the 14th century, so around the 1300s, it's been there a long time. And then when you go to Isabella Stewart Gardner's, in her day it was called Fenway Court. When she passed away, it became the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum. And you see this, obviously, this is the Venetian arches here. And you look into the courtyard and you're just like, oh my gosh, this is very much like the Hotel Danieli, probably with better plants. But it's an incredible, incredible place. And, you know, in Back Bay in Boston, it's an amazing gem that we have here. And it's just incredible to go there. And of course, it has one of Titian's masterpieces, Rape of Europa, 1562. It was not stolen in the heist back in 1990. They actually had an exhibit of it just a couple of years ago where I think it's like four or five paintings that were painted as a series here, and they got them all together and showed them at the Gardner. And it was a pretty amazing exhibit. This one is back to where it belongs in the Titian room. So she has a separate room in the Gardner called the Titian room. And the story of this is Zeus takes the form of a bull and comes down to earth and basically rapes the goddess Europa. And one of the offspring is Minos. And if you know the story of Crete, King Minos, Minotian palace, the Minotaur, all that kind of stuff is that. So he is actually the offspring of Zeus. So these mythology things, it's amazing how they kind of come together. But I thought that was kind of interesting, where actually you look at this painting and the offspring of that is what is associated with Crete. So quickly into architecture, and it is an amazing place. There's a very famous book or series of volumes called The Stones of Venice. It's written by the Englishman John Ruskin in 1851 to 1853. Ruskin is one of these people who is somebody said, did Jupiter take the form of an ox? Ox, bull. But Ruskin's one of these guys that I don't think a lot of people know him, but once you're aware of him, he pops up everywhere. And I came across him when he was, I think it actually is Zeus, not Jupiter. Zeus is the Greek god. But he is a very, very big proponent of Turner. So he has a lot to do with kind of making Turner what he is today, which is basically considered, you know, the quote unquote best British artist ever. So he's an art critic. He's all over the place. He's an art critic. He's an architecture critic. He's a social theorist. He writes himself. He's actually a pretty good draftsman, painter, sketch artist. A lot of his books, Stones of Venice, he does actually sketch out some of the locations that he's talking about. And they're not your average. I mean, he knew how to draw. I mean, he wasn't a Turner, but he certainly was a decent artist. And he has a lot of opinions on Venice, spent a lot of time there. And he ends up writing this three-volume book, which I will admit is you know, to the 21st century eyes, is a bit difficult to get through, and it's very flowery. And the funny thing about it is he has very strong opinions. And it is kind of interesting to read Victorian takedowns of various buildings in Venice. But I will say, when he talks about the stones of Venice, he means the stones of Venice. He gets down to like individual, how the stone is cut and how a window is cut into it and everything else. So he gets very, very detailed. Fortunately, you know, we have other people who can interpret stuff for us. So this book, unfortunately, it wasn't available in the Merrimack Valley Library Consortium, but it was a book written in 2000, called Ruskin's Venice, The Stones Revisited. And it's a photographer, Sarah Quill, who lives in Venice. And she basically went back and took excerpts of various things that Ruskin said in The Stones of Venice and photographs them today. And of course, the interesting thing about Venice, one of the probably more unique things about Venice is, for a large part, it hasn't changed. You know, they're not adding too much land onto it. Napoleon did knock down, he knocked down like 40 churches. But in general, Venice, you know, St. Mark's Basilica has been around since like 1063. So the point being, if you take pictures of what somebody wrote about Venice in the mid-1800s, there's a good chance that's still there today. And so she has done that. And it's a wonderful volume that gives you a good entrance into Ruskin. And this is just a picture of a plaque they put up in 1877, kind of commemorating Ruskin, because he was such a proponent of Venice. And the Stones of Venice became really, in the 1800s, the go-to documentation on Venice. And so you really can't talk about the architecture of Venice without talking about the Basilica San Marco. And as I mentioned, the version we see today was begun in 1063. Somebody asked, can I repeat the name of the hotel that inspired it? It's the Hotel Danieli. So it's Danielle with an I on the end. And it houses the relics of St. Mark. It's dome structure. It's got five domes. So that really, you know, goes more to the Byzantine Empire, to the East, Constantinople, that kind of stuff. So once again, you kind of have this whole blending of East and West. You know, Rome isn't that far away, but its architecture is looking more East. And what it's really noted for, a lot of things, is actually this striated marble is amazing, but also mosaics, kind of amazing mosaics. And once again, goes to the Byzantine Empire. And it's a crowded place. So we plan things pretty, like I said, if you want to go to places like Florence or Rome or Paris, if you don't plan where you're going, you can get yourself into a situation where you have to wait in line a long time for stuff. So we kind of winged Venice more than we normally do. The only thing we got stuck waiting in line for was St. Mark's. And this is our line, because the entrance to St. Mark's, you have to go around the corner there. But it was not bad. It was in the 50s. It wasn't hot. It wasn't cold. Unfortunately, we had these, I think these are the Italian versions, Jersey barriers, but they were all over the Piazza San Marco. And so I don't have a lot of pictures really of the Piazza San Marco, because these things were everywhere and they kind of ruined the view. But this is basically the line. And you can see here, this is actually the Doge's Palace. And then you go to St. Mark's. And this is a kind of a fisheye view. We have the Campanile here, which is the clock tower, which actually collapsed in 1902, and they rebuilt it. Unfortunately, nobody was killed, which is kind of crazy, but it collapsed in 1902 and is rebuilt a lot lighter. So they hope it's not going to collapse. But this gives you kind of a sense of what you're looking at. in a condensed view with a wide angle lens of what you see in St. Mark's Square. And you have the Doge's Palace here, you have St. Mark's Basilica, and then you have the Campanile, which you can go up into. Once again, this requires a separate line, separate ticket. You can get up there and get good views. Although from what I read, the best views are at the island across the way because those views are looking at the island of Venice. Here, you're looking away from the island of Venice. That being said, I'm sure it's still a pretty nice view. So, you know, you got lots of people, you're kind of herded through this. It's the typical touristy thing. You're not in there very long, but it is amazing. It is really amazing. And we were there, Easter, I guess the Tuesday after Easter. So Easter was Sunday and we were there on the Tuesday after Easter, I believe. So there were a fair number of people there, but you can see that it's a beautiful place. And you had the mosaics. So here you have these gold leaf here and these mosaics that are I try to get all the different arches you have because you have these five different domes that are going on. You have all these arches and, you know, different windows, lights coming in, gold. And there's various levels of, if you want to pay more, there's a separate museum. There's a terrace that you can get a view of St. Mark's Square. So just getting in. And recently they did start charging. The church used to be free. And now they charge, I think it's 3 or 5 euros. It's not that expensive, but you have to pay just to get in. And then if you want to go farther in or to the museum, you have to pay on top of that. But in each one of those kind of had a line on top of it. So we ended up going through the basic part of St. Mark's and that was it. But I will say that it was certainly worth it. And did I miss any of the mosaics? No. And then you look down and there are mosaics on the floor as well. So it's just an amazingly intricate place and it's beautiful. I certainly recommend it. And you can get skip the line tickets and things along those lines. And in the summer, it's a different ball game. From what I hear, it's just unbelievable because in the summer they do have the Biennale art festival. And of course you have all this tourism in the summer and then you add about 30 degrees to the temperature. So I would highly recommend going in April. So the other thing you hear about when you talk about architecture in Venice, you come up with Andrea Palladio. He was probably, outside of Michelangelo, the most famous Renaissance architect. And he's associated with Venice. I think he was actually born in Padua, which is a city, not too far from Venice. But he actually didn't do that much in Venice. He is really does a lot of the villas. So as I mentioned before, Venice itself doesn't have a landed aristocracy because there's no land. But as you go back into the mainland, there's the town of Veneto. There's a couple other cities around there that he builds villas for the rich folks. And so he's noted for those and really building houses. But he was involved in about 4 churches on Venice. Or around Venice. And so this is on actually the island of Giudecca, as I showed at the beginning. Giudecca is across the Giudecca Canal from the main island of Venice. And so I dragged my family over there because I wanted to see Palladio and I wanted to go to Giudecca. And I think that was the right call, actually. It's very quiet over there. The architecture is very similar to Venice. You have to take a Vaporetto to get over there, and we'll get into that in a second. But it was quiet, and it was a wonderful place. And we were in there, and we were one of the few people in this church. You compare this with what we went through in San Marco, get this place basically to ourselves. And so the interesting thing about Palladio is I kind of highlighted John Ruskin, and I highlight Palladio. Ruskin hated Palladio. Ruskin does not like symmetry. Doesn't like the kind of, Greek and Roman elements and then slapping this on top. And he can't have enough bad things to say for the most part about Palladian architecture, but I'm not an architecture critic. It's an amazing space, the whites and everything. Like I said, I was just kind of comparing also with the fact that you were kind of, ushered through or herded through San Marco, and here you just basically can walk in and spend as much time as you want. And Palladio writes, they're called the 4 books of architecture, the 4 orders, and they're incredibly influential. Thomas Jefferson is a huge fanboy of Palladio. Basically, Monticello is directly based on one of Palladio's villas. Jefferson was constantly tinkering with Monticello, but he was really trying to create a Palladian vision of kind of symmetry and the space and things along those lines. So he's very influential. A lot of the concepts of architecture still come down to this day. And since he wrote it down in the 1570s, he's had staying power. And this is the interior. Like I said, there's just nobody, and this is the altar. with the crown. Love the kind of checkerboard floor, but it's a beautiful place. And of course, what he's most famous for today is the Palladium window, which a lot of us maybe are familiar with and don't realize the name, but this is what he is today. This, you know, it's got the name. And so this whole arch window, two side windows, and sometimes you'll see just a single arch window referred to as a Palladium window. But if you're looking for influences of Palladio and you see that name, it's like, ooh, that's still being used today. So that will bring us to Venice today. So the interesting thing about Venice is, this is not my picture. I don't have a drone, and if I did, I wouldn't have brought it with me to Venice, but this is the causeway, which has railroad tracks on it and a road. So Venice is no longer really an island. This is actually the train station there. And we kind of stayed over here, right behind the train station. And it goes off over here, and this is the Piazzale Roma, which is basically the bus station and where the taxis from the airport drop you off. So the fact we were staying in Canareggio, I will say, if I can pat ourselves on the back, was a little bit of genius, because it's super easy to get here. I mean, you just basically kind of get dropped off here, go across the Constitution Bridge, walk up an alley here, and where Airbnb was. And you have to get down to San Marco. Really, the only way to get to San Marco is by water taxi. And as you know, you don't travel very far on the water. But this, for all intents and purposes, the train viaduct was built in the 1840s, I believe. And I think the road was built in the 1860s. But for all intents and purposes, this, you know, took Venice off from being an island. But the Carnival is another thing that's kind of really come in recently within the scape of Venice, and the fact that this has been around since the 11th century, but it kind of flittered away. And the 1970s, obviously based on tourism, came back. And so now the Carnival, which is, you know, basically Carnival, Mardi Gras, all that kind of stuff, Fat Tuesday, is a big deal in Venice. I guess even before, in the 11th, 12th, 13th century, it would go on for like 6 months. It doesn't go on like that today, but it is quite the spectacle. So it's another thing, if you're going to Venice, to kind of pay attention to, because it gets very crowded. But even when it's not going on, there are these mask shops. We saw one that was featured in a video, and we kind of walked down, and boom, the guy was there. He's this old time guy making masks. And there's, you know, there's cheap masks, and there's very, very well-made masks, and anything in between. And it's pretty intense, but certainly the remnants of it, or the representation of it, is very much in Venice every day, even though they're not actually celebrating Carnival every day. Like I said, the Biennale is there, alternates each year between art and even years, and then this year is architecture, odd years in the summer. It's a big deal, as far as I know, from an art perspective. It's probably one of the biggest shows in the world. It takes place in and around the Arsenal, began in 1895. It's a big deal to be in the Biennale, and once again, it adds a lot to the summertime crowds. We were wandering through there. We saw a group of folks, and all of a sudden they were like following this gondola, and it turned out they were filming a video, as you see the guy here, for an Italian pop star. His name is Blanco. And there was a guy playing guitar, and Blanco had a very nice voice. He's like a 21-year-old Italian pop star, and they were filming his video in the canals of Venice as we were walking through. That was kind of a nice little bit of serendipity. We did take a canal ride ourselves. I have to admit, I was a bit skeptical. I had heard all kinds of stories about kind of like what happens at the pedal rickshaws in New York. You know, you basically go to do that, and you think you agreed upon a price, and the guy said, oh, I'm at $11 a minute, that type of thing. Nowadays, it is a fixed price. It was 80 euros until about 7 o'clock. It goes up to like 100 or 110 euros. Kind of like the cabs from the airport. The cabs from the airport to the Piazzale Roma were 40 euros. You know, no dickering or anything else. It was 40 euros, and the guy drives you, and it's very pleasant, and it's extremely nice. And I would say the gondola, we have three people in it. I think it can hold up two, I want to say six maybe, but it is pretty amazing. We went some of the back canals, and, you know, once again, as Gore Vidal said, it's the most beautiful cliche, and certainly having a gondola in Venice fits that. But it does have crowds. And as I mentioned before, we came across basically at the bus station, had to come across this new bridge built in 2008 to get across to the side where our Airbnb was. We got there Saturday before Easter, got there at night This bridge, as I'll show you in a second, or a little bit later, it's actually stairs. So to lug your luggage across, there's just all these people. I have to admit, my first hour in Venice, I was kind of done with Venice, but it redeemed itself later on. And the weird part is you just go a few blocks away and there's literally nobody. And it's amazing. So that was, you know, the first night there, I was kind of like, oh my gosh, if, you know, what I just experienced is the way Venice is going to be for the next 4 days. I'm not going to be a happy camper, but it does not take much to get off of the beaten path here. And the vaporettos. So this is the vaporetto. It's their bus service. So there are these boats that zip all over the place. Maybe zip isn't the right term, but they go all over the place. They are expensive. They're 9.5 euros. So it's when we were there, about $10 per trip. And then you get into the whole thing. If you get in, you know, a day pass is 25 euros, 2 day pass is 35 euros, 4 day pass is 45 euros, 3 day pass is 45, 2 day is 25, 2 day is 35, 1 day is 25. So we ended up taking it out to the islands of Burano and Murano. And that was maybe the one thing, if I had to do differently, I would have looked into other transportation out to the islands, because we were passed by other boats, like a drop, hop on, hop off boat service. And it looked like there were very few people on the boat while I was standing for an hour and 15 minutes riding from Venice to Burano. That being said, you know, I gained a grudging appreciation for them, I guess, after a while. It's amazing how they can tie up and cast off very quickly. And the only thing is, you know, and you have to understand this, where there's 55,000 residents and millions of tourists, we got into one situation where the vaporetto filled up with a different line of people, and we were not sure what that was. And after some heated discussion, it turned out that was the locals' line. So the locals had a different line. They were allowed on the vaporetto first. If there's any space left, then the unwashed masses got on, and there was no space left. We were trying to get down to San Marco to beat the crowds, so that plan didn't work. I mean, if I was a native, I get it, but it was a little frustrating. And like I said, so it does, you know, the vaporettos go around here out to Giudecca Canal, so it goes to Giudecca, but you go to Murano, out to Burano, Torcello, I think you can go to Lido, and then you can go up and down the Grand Canal. And around. Actually, it's kind of interesting. We ended up here was a stop, which is kind of near our Airbnb. And actually, the hospital was right on the edge here. So we got to see the Venice Hospital, which I would imagine most tourists, we saw it without having to go into it, I'll say that. So we got to see the hospital the best way you can see it. But I would imagine most tourists are not aware that the hospital is up here. But the vaporetto, I'd say if you're going to use it, probably the 1 or 2 day pass is probably the way to go. And it is interesting, you know, we did get on some trips that were less crowded, and it was pretty cool just, you know, zipping around the Grand Canal and around Venice on these vaporettos. And this is the Constitution Bridge, as I mentioned. You can see it's got these steps that go up, and it's got this glass and these kind of stone things in the middle. And this is the picture of the day we left, and it was raining. And what we found out the hard way was these glass things are basically like ice. And when I got home, I read about this, and it's kind of a classic Italian thing. It's got a great style, but it was built in 2008 by, I forget the guy's name, but he's some well-known architect in Italy. But there's been all kinds of controversy because these things are incredibly slippery. We were not the only people who experienced that. He claims that they've replaced these that don't have the right coating on them. And there's a whole back and forth, but the bottom line is it is a little tough. You can see how steep that really is. This gives you the best view of it. You don't kind of get that when you look at it from the side, but it is, you know, lugging all your luggage up and down this is a little bit of a chore. And particularly when we got there on the Saturday before Easter, they have porters who have big wheeled, almost like wheelbarrows that will move stuff around. But I had never been in the city walking around Venice where I saw so many people dragging their luggage. It's really everywhere. You have to, you know, because there are, I mean, the thing about Venice, and I really didn't mention this, you know, there's nothing but the canals and the boats. So there's no bicycles. There are no cars. There are no scooters. You know, there are no motorbikes. And that, thank God, it's an amazing pedestrian city. We had just come from Athens, which is a great walking city too, but particularly these motorbikes, to me, I find always very difficult because we don't have that kind of thing here in the United States, where these small Vespa type things or a little bit larger motorbikes are kind of coming out of nowhere, weaving in traffic, all that kind of stuff. And, you know, your sensibility really isn't to see those things. So it can be a little stressful when you're walking. You got to pay attention. Not that you shouldn't pay attention anywhere, but in Venice, you know, except for, you know, people say, I'd love to be in Venice when it snows. I'm not sure I agree with that because there are no guardrails between you and the canal. So if you lose your footing, you're going to go. My daughter started kidding me because I would say go in the drink. That term came out of my mouth 100 times when we were in Venice. So other than that, it's an amazing walking city. I would say bar none, the most amazing walking city I've ever been in. It's incredible. So you can't talk about Venice without talking about flooding. They call it Aqua Alta, high water. The flood of 1966 was the one that kind of put it on the map as we got to do something about this. So there was this organization called Save Venice that was started up and it finally became functioning in 1971. There's actually a chapter here in Boston. So if you want to go to a high-priced carnival event at the Harvard Club down in Boston, you can sign up there and the proceeds will go to Venice to help save it. The last major flood was in November 2019. About a year later, in October of 2020, they put together what's called the Mose, which is basically these gates that are trying to block the ocean when it's going to become a super high tide. So I kind of bookend my presentation with the beginning is the crazy technology as to how they built Venice and having to pound the poles in there and, you know, create basically land out of nothing. And here we are, you know, 1500 years later, and they're this incredible architecture, engineering marvel of trying to stop the water from coming into the lagoon. So this is a quick video that was done in CBS in 2020 when this opened up.
For over 1,000 years, the ancient city of Venice, Italy, has been trying to keep floodwaters at bay. Just this week, Venice was flooded when tides surged higher than officials expected. But now a recently completed barrier system has been activated. CBS News foreign correspondent Chris Livesay is in Venice with more.
Now, normally during high tide in Venice, I could have water up to my knees, but take a look around. St. Mark's Square is dry, and it's all thanks to a flood prevention system, one that cost 6.5 billion euros, and it's proving successful. It's far from perfect, but it could be this city's best chance at survival.
Dickens once said you'd shed tears to see Venice. But overnight, as 4 feet of tidal seawater try to engulf the city, it's these 78 retractable dikes that could almost make you weep, says chief engineer Francesco Olsola.
It's a very emotional.
It's called Mose, Italian for Moses, and just like in the Old Testament, it's parting the sea, keeping the Adriatic from swallowing its crown jewel.
For centuries, it was water that protected Venice from invaders until it became the invader itself. Now, these floodgates are the only thing standing between the exquisite and extinction.
Last year, climate change and high tides triggered the worst flooding in more than 50 years, a catastrophe in a city whose lifeblood is its beauty. A catastrophe, this time, averted.
Without the Mose, every day, more or less, every day is flooded.
Technically, it's still a work in progress, says Venice Mayor Luigi Brugnaro. Like a suit of armor, yet with chinks. It takes an excruciating 48 hours to activate. Not enough warning to thwart a flash flood earlier this week, swamping St. Mark's Basilica and workshops like Paolo Brandolizio's, where he's been carving gondola oarlocks for 26 years.
It doesn't take much, does it, for water to come in here?
No,
it's just a few inches away, he says, right at the doorstep, just like the global climate crisis, says environmental scientist Jane DeMosto.
Venice, I think, is the canary in the mine for other places that need to make very radical choices about how to survive in the future.
And for now, Venice's radical choice is working, and climate scientists are saying cities in the U.S., specifically those on the coast, should pay close attention. Places like Los Angeles, Boston, and Miami that could be seeing their own severe flooding in the coming decades. Vlad, Anne-Marie?
All right, Chris Livesay, thank you very much.
So, I'll end it with somebody asked a question about books on Venice that evoke Venice. Probably the one that gets mentioned the most is Jan Morris's The World of Venice, which was, I think, originally written in the 60s, but was updated as recently as 95. But when at last you leave these waters, pack away your straw hat, swing out to sea, all the old dazzle of Venice will linger in your mind, and her smell of mud, incense, fish, age, filth, and velvet will hang around your nostrils, and the soft lap of her back canals will echo in your ears. And whenever you go in life, you will feel somewhere over your shoulder a pink, castellated, shimmering presence, the domes and riggings and crooked pinnacles of the Serenissima. So I'll end with a picture, which I believe is a local. The dog obviously is what attracted me to it. It was, I've never seen a face like that on a dog. I assume that if you have a dog, for the most part, nowadays you can certainly take dogs on vacation, but I kind of assumed he was a local, and kind of evokes a little bit of modern day Venice. So as I mentioned, a lot of sources. I would suggest that Venice, The World of Venice by Jan Morris. Rick Steves, you're actually going to go to Venice. Rick Steves, you know, obviously he's kind of your go-to for any European travel. He does have audio in his app. He has audio tours. We listened to him for San Marco. This was an interesting one I found. It was just recently written, but it's To Venice with Love. And it's this guy who was in Edinburgh. He's a Brit. He was living in Edinburgh as a tech worker and decided to basically, he and his wife, go live in Venice. And so he documents like what it is. He basically was going to teach English and goes through all the adventures and misadventures of trying to get an apartment and all that kind of stuff. It was, kind of an interesting window into what modern day Venice is like. Peter Ackroyd, famous British writer, historian, he has a very detailed book as Venice Pure City. And then Gore Vidal, who, if you're familiar with Gore Vidal, he was pretty amazing guy to a certain, he was very opinionated. He would do wonderful in today's Twitterverse, but he was quite the bon vivant back in the 60s, 70s, and 80s. And he wrote his name, Vidal, actually is Italian. And he was searching out some of his ancestors and ended up in Venice and had a very interesting book with some beautiful photographs in it. So I have a couple of photos up in Silver Center for the Arts in Plymouth, New Hampshire this summer. So if you're up in the Western White Mountains, stop by Plymouth and check it out. My next presentation will be in the fall. I will do something a little more local, Boston Statues, How and What a City Chooses to Remember, a 350-year-old photographic journey. You can find me on Instagram, Facebook, and the web. And we'll get to some questions. So somebody says, what happens if you fall in the canal? besides getting wet, I don't think you want to fall in the canal because it is all, I mean, people talk about the smell of Venice and we didn't really find that. There was a bit of an ocean smell, which I thought was fine. But other than that, it was, you know, we saw the garbage barge. They have garbage to take it in and out, but you know, there's all these motorboats in the canal. So the water there is pretty nasty. And the gondola ride is per person of 80 euros. No, it was 80 euros for the whole gondola ride. Thank goodness. Get to pay to visit churches and museums. Yes. For the most part, and some churches are free, but most are not. And they have a pass where if you want to visit more than like four or five churches, there's a couple of dozen or so that are hooked together. You can get a pass. It's called the choir pass, which is a bit confusing because when you see it, it's kind of like the old Notre Dame in Paris. They used to call it the tours pass, which means tower. But you think you're getting a pass for a tour, but it's actually a tower. They call it a choir tour, but it basically is a bunch of these churches have got together and you pay 12 euros or something. You can visit all these churches you want. So if you really want to go into the whole church thing, I would suggest that. Jupiter, not Zeus, that is correct. Although it was interesting that it happened on Crete, which is where Zeus was born. And of course, Jupiter basically is just the Roman version of Zeus. Somebody talks about the British consul, Joseph Smith. He was a painter's agent, and that's why a lot of Canaletto's paintings are in a British collection. That's interesting. Somebody had some sound issues. Thank you. Are some hotels and restaurants closed in the winter? I don't know. The way Venice is nowadays, they've done a good job. You can kind of debate about, you know, the whole thing of it being overrun. But that being said, it's, you know, they've got tourism going there a lot. So I'm not sure. Like the thing about restaurants, I didn't really get into it. You know, my view is I'm not a gourmand, but the restaurants were mediocre. And if you don't cater to the tourists, you can't really have a restaurant in Venice. If you survive only on locals, you're not going to survive. So we come from Athens, which I thought was exceptional. It's food and value. I didn't think Venice was that. But in the winter, I don't know. I'm not sure all that much is closed because Venice has done a good job. You're gonna assimilate 5 to 20 million tourists a year. You're on a 2x1, literally a 2-square-mile island. You're going to have to be open most of the year. And the largest room in largest room in Europe? Oh, that was the Grand Council Room, and it's not used today at all. It was one of those rooms that just kind of overwhelms you. It's the biggest one, but it has the whole ceiling all painted, and it is just it's like football field size thing, which is, you know, once again gives you the immensity and, you know, the wealth you were talking about with regard to Venice in the Middle Ages. And any other questions? That there's a big problem with large tourist filled ships. Venetians dislike them. Well, I think that's true everywhere. Go to Bar Harbor. They're having a huge issue up in Bar Harbor about cruise ships. So yeah, that's certainly, they come in by San Marco, you know, they basically disembark these people for the day and then they, you know, get off. So the thing I would say about Venice is you do want to spend a night there at least, if not more, because at night it is just, I mean, we had some dinners that were, I said the food was not really exceptional, but the location was exceptional. We had, and it was cool. We had to wear our jacket, but, you know, with one thing about COVID, we're all kind of used to eating outside, maybe have a higher tolerance for it than we would have 5 years ago. And, you know, some of the places we ate were just amazing locations, and, you know, having a meal along the canal in Venice was exceptional. And, you know, you get this in all these cities. Certainly we experienced it in Florence. We were a day tripper in Florence. We were there a few years ago. You know, it's all tour things just a day, just mobbed. And then at night, it's much less so. And so I would say Venice is probably the extreme example of that. And there's no doubt that cruise ships are a huge, huge issue with the way this thing happens. But I would say if you want to experience a place, you'd want to stay there a night or two. So you get to experience it without having the cruise ship crowds there during the day. Venice had the first modern patent law. I did have a slide about Venice first. It is kind of amazing. That actually the place I believe the fork was invented. But a lot of things come from Venice. And like I said, it was really ahead of its time. And it was, you know, you've got the whole industrial place with the arsenal. You had the monetary and fiscal policy happening in the Middle Ages, the 1300s and the 1400s, which is really far in advance of other things that you see. So there's no doubt that Venice was at the forefront of a lot of things today that we take for granted. Okay, I think I have got all the questions. So thanks, everyone.
Thank you, everyone, again, for joining us. And of course, thank you, Bruce, so much for this great presentation. Personally, selfishly, thank you so much for the travel tips. I will keep those in mind. I hope everyone else does too. It's on my bucket list. So everyone, let's go to Venice. Again, thank you, everyone, for joining us tonight. Keep a lookout for your emails. I believe Jess may be sending out a recording of tonight's presentation. Keep a lookout for that. But otherwise, again, Bruce, thank you so much. And everyone, have a good night.
Thanks.